Good evening, everybody. How y'all doing tonight? So about 10 or 9 months ago, I contacted, maybe about a year ago, I contacted this guy named Cliff Duren, who's an arranger in Atlanta. And I said, hey, you know, I really feel led by God to do a choir project. I feel led to do recording. And a lot of people do recordings, but there's something special when God tells you to do it. Amen? I told the choir back there, when God calls you to do it, he's going to provide the resources, he's going to provide the people, and he's going to provide the time, and he did it every step of the way. So can we give God glory real quick? We are so grateful to see you here tonight. My name is Pastor Forbes. For any visitors, I'm the worship and arts pastor here at Princeton Church. They actually let me talk and sing, which is very dangerous. But we're so glad you're here tonight. We always say on Sunday morning that this is not a concert, it's a service. And tonight, it's a little different. We are going to do a concert. We're going to sing 10 songs for you, the entire album. And we will have you home before halftime. Does that sound good? So trust me, we got tacos and queso dip waiting back at home, so I'm ready to eat that. No, but we're going to have a great time in the Lord tonight. But I do want to clarify and have one disclaimer. If we feel like we're capturing a moment here, if we feel like you're worshiping with us in your seats, and we just want to sing something, is that okay if we just sing something at the end of the chorus? This is a house of God. And I told the choir, the beautiful singing aside, worshiping him is first tonight. Amen? Cliff Duren has flown in from Atlanta, our arranger, to play piano tonight. Can we welcome him to pray with us over our concert?
Boy, this is, don't you guys know that there's a football game on and nobody goes to church on Sunday nights? This is amazing. Like, praise the Lord. When I saw those doors open at 5:20 and the host of people already waiting to come in, it so filled my soul to see this kind of enthusiasm just to come together and worship. Praise the Lord for tonight and this opportunity. I am so glad to have met Forbes and then to have met this wonderful choir. I do want to tell you, having recorded a few choirs throughout the last few years, you've got a very, very special thing going here. The Lord's really using this group of folks behind me, and it really was. A few weeks ago when we were here, it was the best on-site choir recording session that I've ever been a part of was here in this church. And so you guys, and I promise that's not a line I use at every church I go to, okay? Hand on the Bible, I promise, all right? But you know, before I just want to pray for our evening, but I couldn't help but just thinking about the songs we're going to sing tonight. And I really do hope you'll join in with us. I heard a quote this week, and this is not exactly it. It was from John Piper, and he used bigger words than I'm about to use, but he said, sometimes when it comes to the Lord, the only thing appropriate is to sing. The only appropriate response is to sing to the Lord. Sometimes saying it's not enough. So tonight, I pray that you would feel that freedom to join in with us, but here's what David said in Psalm 95. He said, oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. And let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. And then he gives us the reason why. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. One commentator says that's David's way of saying he's the only real one. Tonight we're going to sing a song called Only Worthy One. Did you know that all this work the choir has put into this, all the work in praying that Forbes has done, it's not for a CD, it's not for a recording, it's because the gospel is worth it. It's because the worship of the one true God, he's the only one worthy of this kind of effort and of this evening. And so of these songs we're going to sing, he's the only one worthy of us singing these songs to him. And so tonight, let's worship together and come into the presence of the Lord with thanksgiving for this opportunity. I'm so grateful to be with you. Let's pray together. God, we are already, Lord, just so humbled in your presence tonight. I'm thankful for this church, and I'm thankful, God, for your movement in this place, God, how you're using this ministry, how you're using this choir, this band. And so, God, I know we've talked about this, Lord, the resource that these songs are going to be for other churches. So just the thought about you multiplying what is going to happen here tonight and using it, God, and church after church across this nation, God, we celebrate that already. We thank you in advance for those who will be engaged in worship because of this project and those who will hear the gospel because of this project, God. So, Lord, have your will and way tonight, God. Hear our praises as we call on your name, the one true God. And all God's people said, amen.
Good evening. Pastor Forbes had mentioned to us before we sing this song, if we would share our testimonies. And I will tell you, I can get up here and sing and hold it together, but when you have to talk about what God has brought you through, sometimes that'll bring some emotion. And we serve such a good God. And I can tell you, I'm going to keep this short. And I know Pastor Forbes doesn't believe that, but I'm really going to keep this short, okay? I promise. But I want to start just really quickly from birth. No, seriously. When I was born right here in Princeton, and I have lived here all my life. And I grew up in a family who loved me, and I never had to question if I was loved. And I grew up with parents and brothers and had a wonderful childhood growing up. I went to Princeton School. It was a union school then, so it was K-12. And I went to school there all my life and enjoyed my friends and enjoyed doing all the things that kids like to do. Enjoyed high school. I played sports. I love sports. And just had a really normal, happy childhood. And I got to college, and I started dating Seth, who is my husband, and he's here tonight. And at that time, his dad was the pastor here at our church. And we were dating, and I was in college for elementary education, and everything seemed to be going wonderful in my life. I can honestly say that, you know, other than those typical little things that you go through, you know, sometimes you got those little valleys you go through, but nothing major. I had such a good life. Everything had gone my way. Everything that I had ever gone through had pretty much been up on the mountain. And so I was in college, and we finished school and ended up getting married. And then, after 2 years of marriage, I found out I was having a baby. And not only did I find out I was having one baby, but when I went to the doctor, I found out I was having two babies. I was having twins. And we were so excited. And even at 7 weeks, when you see that ultrasound picture and you see what God has created already, you see those heartbeats, they're your babies and you love them. They are yours. And so I was pregnant with twins and I was so excited. And everything was going wonderful except for, you know, your typical morning sickness. And I felt bad throughout the day for about 17 weeks, but everything was going well. And I found out that I was having identical twin boys. So we were excited. And, you know, you already have their names. You're picking out their names and you're making these future plans for them. And you just are so excited. And everybody's so excited for you. You have your shower. Your nursery smells like powder. Everything's going wonderful. And then it was at 28 weeks pregnant. It was a teacher work day, and I was sitting at my desk, and my teacher's assistant was talking to me, and we were getting everything ready, and all of a sudden I knew I didn't feel right, and found out that I was going into preterm labor. And so they took me to Johnston Memorial by ambulance, and I was actually a patient at Chapel Hill, and so they had to stop there along the way. And so they stopped at Johnston Memorial, and someone in our church who was a nurse that was on duty, the doctor allowed her to ride in the ambulance with me all the way to Chapel Hill. And as we were riding, she kept saying, "Tracy, you know I had a premature baby, and you're going to be okay. You're going to be okay." It was Ellen Coates, and she said, "You're going to be okay." And it just, you know, that was God allowing this person that I knew to comfort me on that ride to the hospital. And she kept telling me, "I've been in your situation. I have had a child at 28 weeks, I think." And she said, "You're going to be okay." She held my hand. She went all the way to the hospital with me. And when we got there, you know, she left and my family joined me there. And I was able to actually be on bed rest for a couple of weeks there before I actually had to deliver my boys. But that was just a scary time. So I delivered them at 30 weeks. And when I delivered them, they were doing really well overall, but their lungs were very underdeveloped. And so they call these babies, Caucasian males are called, I don't know if you know this, but in a NICU, Caucasian males are called wimpy white boys because they do not do as well in the NICU. Their lungs are usually not as strong. And so we were in the NICU there, and I was 30 weeks, and the babies were doing okay, but they were struggling. Now, remember, all my life, everything had kind of gone my way. I had never truly had to rely on giving everything. Like, I had it. I always have been able to have all my problems fixed by my mom or my dad or my friends. And here I was, and I'm like, I can't do this, Lord. Like, this is the scariest thing I've ever been through. And so I could already feel the prayers of the church. I could feel the scripture that was being prayed to us, sent to us. That was before social media. But I knew that people were praying over us. And then about a week and a half after we had been there, the boys, you know, were slowly, they were on ventilators and things like that, but they were slowly progressing. And then one day Seth came up to the hospital, and I'm going to have to get some water, I'm sorry. Seth came up to the hospital on a Wednesday night. He had had to go to work, and he came into my room and he said, "Tracy, the doctors just met me in the NICU." And I had not been able to go down there that night because I had a fever. And he said, "Grant," which was our smaller baby, he said, "he's not doing well." And I said, "What do you mean?" And I just fell apart. And for the first time, I had to just say, "God, you have to help me because I can't do this by myself. I can't. My mom can't fix this. My dad can't fix this. My mother and father-in-law, you know, who we clung to our family, they couldn't fix it for the first time ever." And yes, I had always prayed, and yes, I believed in God, and I relied on Him, but I truly had to give it all to Him because I knew I couldn't do it. And that's exactly what we did. And Seth looked at me, I will never forget, and he said, you know, after 2 weeks in that NICU, after actually 19 days, he didn't survive. He didn't live. And I remember Seth looking at me and saying, "Tracy, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away, but blessed be the name of the Lord." And I've been reading in Job over the last couple of weeks, and I read that scripture of all that Job went through. And I remember thinking, "Lord, I can't ask you why me. There are people all around me hurting. There are people in all these bad situations. Why not me? Who am I? You never promised that we wouldn't go through things like this as Christians. It's not easy being a Christian. We still have to go through trials, but you still told us that you had overcome the world. You would never leave us and you would never forsake us. And we had to put every bit of our trust in Him. And that's what we did. That's when we were put to the test, and that's what we did." So I just want to share with you, Luke continued to stay in the hospital, and he stayed for 5 months, and he finally came home on oxygen. And then after about 9 months, I took Luke to get portraits made, and I realized that I had not had his oxygen turned on while we were there. And we realized that, hey, Luke can survive without oxygen. Yeah! I will never forget that. I was like, "Oh my goodness," for the first time I didn't turn his oxygen on. But he was fine. He was fine. And we were like, "Yes!" So Luke came off of oxygen at getting his pictures made that day. But Luke is here tonight, and Luke is going on 20 years old, and Luke is the most laid-back kid in the world, and we are so proud of him, and we are so thankful for him. And I will tell you this. I look back now, and as we sing this song in a few minutes, I see all that God brought us through, that He was with me and Seth and our family, and He's with you every step of the way when you don't even realize it. When I was growing up, having all those mountaintop moments, He was right there, and He was preparing me because He knows that we're going to go through things. He was preparing me for what was to come and all the things I was going to have to go through. And He made sure that I was surrounded by a loving family. I had a wonderful church family growing up. I had all those things. And then in that moment, when I finally had to give it all to Him, I knew that He had prepared that way, because guess who I needed during that time more than any time ever in my life? I needed my church family. I needed those scriptures. They just started ringing true in my head, and I was like, "That's what that scripture means." And then I started thinking of all the songs we had sung in choir that I had probably stood up here and sung so dully and never really put it into context of what those songs really meant. And then all of a sudden I was like, "Oh my goodness, that's what those songs are talking about." And then when we had to let Grant go, I will never forget saying, that's the peace that passes all understanding. I never knew that before. I never had to know that. But now, if I didn't know that, I don't know where I'd be. And so I'm so thankful for Jesus being with me through the good. And I saw him carry me through the bad. And I'm here today because he was there beside of me, and he will never leave me, and he will never forsake me. And I know that life is not going to be perfect when I walk off of this stage, and I'm going to go through other things, but I can leave knowing that he's never going to leave me. And if you do not know Jesus tonight, I want you to know that he loves you, and he loves you so much, and he wants you, because you're going to go through things if you haven't already. He wants you to have a church family. He wants people to pray scripture over you. He wants you to listen to this music tonight and absorb everything it's saying, because one day those words are going to mean something if they don't already. So I'm so thankful that there was Jesus for me through it all, and he'll never leave me now.
Yes, my name's Mike. My story begins about age 10. Now, years prior to that, I didn't like myself. I didn't know what I wanted to be like other kids when they grew up, and I really did not like myself. So I took my first drink. I battled a 13-year alcohol and drug addiction starting at age 10, and it progressed from then on there. You know, it was like a eureka moment when I took that first sip. Everything that I was feeling inside of me went away. And I knew then it was the alcohol and the drugs that helped me feel better at that time. And I just chased that dragon for years. And in 2007, I was hitting rock bottom, and I had tried getting clean on my own, and I would stay sober but not clean, and I'd stay clean but not sober, and I couldn't do both at the same time. And my family came together. They came to me, and they gave me, you know, options. They said, you know, we love you, we care for you, we know what's been going on, this is what we see, and these are the options. And, you know, I didn't realize it then, but it was, you know, it was the fact that I was trying to quit on my own, and asking God, you know, why can't I do this? And I was in that frustration moment. I was down on my knees, and it was God's way of saying, I'm opening the door for you. You know, you're here, you're asking me. And this is my way of saying I love you, I'm here. And so my family gave me that option, and I took it. So today I'll be sober in April, sober and clean for 14 years. Yeah. My daughter was young at the time, and she's going to be 18 this year, and she doesn't get to see that father anymore. And my son is 10, and he will never be able to see, or will never get to see that side of me. My wife, who I've known since the first grade, who has stood by me through thick and thin, and checked on me during my addiction, you know, I love doing life with her. And she's my rock, and she guides me, you know, when I have my rough times. So, you know, I grew up Catholic, so I didn't have that religious background. And when I went to church when I was younger, it was for the girls. And so, you know, when I walked in this church years ago, it was like it hit me, you know, I gave up all my character defects that were pulling me, you know, right and left to go the wrong way. And you know, I believe in my heart that God had all the part in that. And he's turned my life 360 degrees. I get to be that role model for my kids, to help guide them spiritually. And that's a blessing. So that's it. Yeah. crashing to the ground. When the friends I had were nowhere to be found. I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. There was Jesus. In the way, in the search, in the healing and the hurt, like a blessing buried in the broken.
Hope alive from the beginning to end. You're
just lift him up in your own voice tonight.
We magnify the name of Jesus. You're merciful, you're good. We thank you for your blood that washes us clean.
I don't know about where you came from, but I know where I was when God found me. Some of my family's in the room, they know where I was when God found me. Are you grateful for the grace of God that covers all your sin? Come on, just sit in this moment for a second. If you're not used to being at church with us, we're just taking a moment. We're just lifting up the name of Jesus together. Just had to take a moment here. Do you feel his presence in this place tonight? We say it all the time at church. When you believe in Jesus, he lives in your heart. We don't have to sing to whip up his presence, and somehow he's always with us. So we got a couple more songs to sing tonight, but I just want your heart to be encouraged that our Savior's love for us is strong and never ending, and there's no place you can run, there's no place you can hide, there's no sin too deep that he cannot cover tonight. Lord Jesus, we just thank you for your presence here today. We just lift up your name. Father, we offer these songs as a sacrifice of praise for all that you've done. And we give you glory, honor, and praise. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated as we continue.
Bound by my shame and sin, but even if I give you all of me, Jesus.
Lord, we give you all, Jesus. I love you. I love you, Lord. Do you love Jesus in this place today? We know that he's the only worthy one, amen. Jesus is the reason for doing everything we do. We don't do anything here at this church without him telling us to. And we don't do what he doesn't tell us to do. And that's it. It's just that simple, amen. He is good, he is loving, and he is kind, and he's here for you. We've got one more song to close out the evening, and this has become an anthem for our hearts. That the name of Jesus is above every other name. We started off this concert singing, "For God So Loved." And if you know that to be true tonight, if this is your salvation message, then it's time to just lift up the name of Jesus. Amen. We're going to ask you to stand to your feet. And you may not know the song tonight, but just sing it with us as you learn it. Is that all right? Let's lift up his great name tonight.
God, this is about you. Jesus, this is about you. God, we give you thanks and we give you praise that you are mighty. You are powerful. There is no one who can challenge your name. And tonight, God, we praise you and thank you that you have reminded us through this album release concert that, God, you never leave us. You never forsake us. For the person here today who is struggling, who says, I feel all alone. I feel like I'm the only one going through it. God, may they be reminded that you're with them. And God, that there's a host of people around, body of Christ, who are walking through the same things. So God, may you fill our hearts with hope. May you fill our hearts with peace. And God, may you call out to those who are lost. God, may we be a light so that others might see our good works, but glorify our Father in heaven. God, we're still believing in the prodigal sons. Come on, somebody. We're still believing that the prodigals are gonna come home. We're still believing that the lost are gonna come home. And God, we thank you, Heavenly Father, and we give you glory for the work that you have done here on this night. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody says, amen. Amen. Andrew, if you could turn the house lights up just a little bit. I wanna bring forward just an incredible couple that deserves some honor tonight. I'd love for Pastor Forbes and Bailey to come up. Carrie Beth, if you would join. Do you love this couple? Let them know right now. Young Jackrabbit came to me in March. It'll be 6 years. He was a single man. We weren't sure there was a woman out there that would want him. And then this lady came along. The truth is they were already engaged, and what a blessing Forbes and Bailey Talley have been to Princeton Church. We love you and thank you so much. Also tonight, I want to give special thanks to Cliff Duran on the keys. Thank you, Cliff. Thank you for taking a chance on a little church in eastern North Carolina outside of the outskirts of Raleigh. And we're just so thankful for that. And ladies and gentlemen, how about this choir? Come on, give it up for them. So thankful for you. Our guys on strings, incredible. Thank you so much. Last but not least, we just want to tell you thank you. Thank you so much for being here tonight. And I got to tell you, there's some incredible churches here in this community. Incredible churches that you could be a part of and maybe are a part of. And if you are, we encourage you, stay planted right where you're at. But if you don't have a church home, we'd love to have the opportunity to love you. We'd love to have the opportunity to care for you. We'd love to have the opportunity to remind you that our Lord and Savior, He loves you. Nowhere you can go that you can leave His presence. And so tonight, as we finish up, can we just pray and thank Him for being here with us tonight as we finish this wonderful evening. God, we just thank you. We thank you, Heavenly Father. Come on, pray with me. Don't listen to me. Pray with me. God, we thank you for this evening where your presence is evident. God, where your promise was fulfilled that where two or three would gather in your name, there you are also. And so God, we just thank you. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that you're good and you're faithful. We thank you, God, that you're forgiving. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that you've brought us together as a body of believers and reminded us, behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brothers and sisters to dwell together in unity. God, I pray, Heavenly Father, today that you would bless every person here, God. God, may your presence shower down upon them. May every person in this house be overflowing with the Spirit of God, and may the joy of the Lord be their strength as we leave this place with the goodness and the faithfulness of God reminded to our spirits. In Christ's name we pray, and everyone here says amen. God bless you today as you leave. Thank you so much for being a part of this album release.